Welcome to the Bauer Power Hour, where we pack motorsports, power sports, and the outdoor lifestyle with technology, innovation, news, and good times into an action-packed dirt-flinging show. Hosted by the one and only Charlene Bauer, who's been serving the off-road industry for over 20 years. Time to throw the green flag and get ready for another wild lineup.
Hi, I'm Charlene Bauer, and welcome to another episode of Bauer Power Hour. We're at the Arizona Off-Road and Sand Expo at Westworld of Scottsdale in Arizona. Of course, I had to find the KTM to sit on first thing this morning. This is a two-stroke, ding-da-ding-ding-ding, right? Nothing better than a two-stroke in the morning. Or are you a four-stroke kind of guy? Brop, brop, brop. Of course, I know how to make all the noises. Isn't this fun? In fact, this is actually what I ride when we go to the dunes. So I loved it when I saw the paddle tire too. We still have a lot of work to do today. We're gonna head into some of these booths. We're gonna see more cool stuff, and we're gonna head outside into the Arizona heat and see what's out there. So, you guys ready? Let's peel out.
If you drive a utility vehicle, Jeep, or motorcycle, Kicker Audio has the Power Sports Stereo gear to entertain you at any location. The gear is compact, weatherproof, and provides you with great sounding music wherever the job or fun takes you. See your authorized Kicker dealer for your off-road tunes.
We're here with Nick from the Geiser Brothers. So exciting. You guys always have like top of the line trophy trucks and class ones and everything, right?
Yeah, we do. We manufacture trophy trucks, and now we're doing 6100s, which is definitely a new class. We have actually 15 6100s out racing. And we also have five trucks that are over in Australia, and we're building another one, so it's pretty cool. But our new greatest, latest thing that you're asking about is a full drive. That truck is definitely the new bar has been risen. That truck cycles the same amount of suspension travel as a normal trophy truck. It actually weighs about the same as a normal trophy truck, fully loaded with 92 gallons of fuel in it, which is pretty cool. The other advantage of it is a two-wheel drive truck has, like, we call it slippage, which is like wheel spin. So most trucks are average from 28% to 32%. The new four-wheel drive did 1.8%. So it also got almost 3 miles a gallon to the Vegas Torino race, which is pretty ecstatic. So it did really good. We're just going to keep making it lighter and better. We already have a couple other teams already wanting to buy them, but we're going to wait a year and do some research and testing with this truck and make sure it's dialed before we go. It also has the most advanced computer system out of any of the trucks we've ever done. It has onboard PDMs, that two onboard computers basically that are constantly learning and taking information from the from all the sensors and stuff that's on the vehicle. It runs dual fuel pumps, dual crank triggers, dual TPSs, shock temperatures, taking all the information and constantly making itself better. It has a redundant system, so if anything fails, like a fuel pump starts to fail or get low on fuel, another one will kick in to subsidize to make the fuel pressure stay the same. So, which helps out in the racing, so there's no downtime, because races nowadays are coming down to pit stops and seconds. You know, like the Baja 500 was won by 10 seconds, which is really crazy. So to go 500 miles and not be able to lose by 10 seconds is pretty heartbreaking. So we're to that point where just the little things of them being able to switch and not having malfunctions while driving is a really key point. So
So you were saying that you've worked there for 10 years. And exactly that. Like, it's coming down to seconds now. The amount of technology that's going into these trucks is just incredible. How have you seen, or what's really, like, the number one piece that you can identify that's changed in that time?
We definitely, the motor and like the computer stuff has been a big part. If you look in some of the new trucks, like, we don't have the toggle switches, so like some people think it's cool and having all the switch panels, but now it's all push button and LCD screens and the data logging, which is really critical, where now the driver doesn't have to be like, oh, he can say it did something, well, here the computer charts tell it differently. So we're able to take all the data. The engine builders are constantly logging into the trucks right after the races and taking all the information and just looking at it and telling you what the truck does, how to fix it, how to make it better. And just like really the computer stuff is what's making it the advancement. We're also going to like new components, like we have a full carbon fiber body coming out for a truck, carbon fiber panels, Yeah, lighter and faster, and we're making titanium spacers for everything. We also designed our own new forged wheel that's coming out. So the forged wheels are lighter than cast wheels and stronger, so that's a new key point that we're trying to get into the whole thing. So
as we go lighter, you're also saying stronger, and sometimes those two words don't necessarily go together.
Yeah.
So at what point do you understand the metallurgy that goes into it, or how does that work? Like, how do you know when to go lighter and when to say stronger?
Really, it's trial and error, but we do have a lot of research and development that we've done. Computers help a lot, so our wheels have been analyzed and tested all on computers, so we know how strong they are. Also, we just have a lot of information from people, like our fiberglass guys tell us how to do it and what's going to make it stronger. We also use like Kevlar mix, so it's half carbon fiber, half Kevlar, so that stuff's stronger and still protects the bodies and everybody inside. So just some of the like knowledge base of where we're coming from. We're also trying to advance our like friendship base with other customers that have other ideas and have different ways of bringing new thoughts and processes to the table. We have constantly just coming out and researching and stuff, which is a big part of why we come out to the shows, just to see new vendors, see new ideas, just new things. I mean, I met probably 10 people today. I have new products and new ideas that maybe we didn't think of and that they bring to the table to help us make our trucks that much better, because we need those 10 seconds. And so just whatever to help make the process better is really what we're looking at.
How many trucks are out there that have Geiser Brothers' name on it? How many have you guys built over the years? Do you have any idea?
Yeah, we just built truck number 62. We actually have three more trucks getting built right now. And like I said, one's going to Australia. We have another 6100 getting built, and then we have another trophy truck getting built. So, which is pretty amazing for us. We didn't really feel a lot of the economy because the people were fortunate to have customers that have the budgets in the spending process, so which is pretty cool. So, but yeah, we're just really fortunate to see where we're going and advancements, and like the new full drive truck's gonna just be another stepping stone into the process. So we'll see where everything goes, and like I said, we're also going to the shows, so we're gonna start making products to sell to the general public. So we just have some of the racers can't necessarily afford our $500,000 trucks, so we want to definitely try to help some of those guys and that are racing and helping the sport progress, you know. So we're here to just meet with them, get ideas on what to build, and just help, you know. And most of those guys are creative, so some of the times we see some of the like less guys have to make something work out of nothing, so it's kind of cool to see what they make. So
I saw online over the last couple weeks where somebody said that your new four-wheel drive Geiser truck has completely changed the industry. Like, this is a game-changer vehicle.
Yes. Yeah, it totally is. I've ridden in the truck when testing with it. And, I mean, I have ridden in two-wheel drive trucks, too, with some of the awesome drivers like Robbie Gorin and Rob Mack. And just to see how that truck handles compared to a two-wheel drive truck is just amazing. It's just going to change the game and how trucks go and stuff and just how they handle and how they maneuver. So, and just like I said, it's 10 seconds. Now that's 10 seconds in the corner they don't have to spin. So it definitely comes into a new game changer plan of just how you drive. And like I said, it still cycles the same. So there's no advantages or disadvantages so far that we've found to the four-wheel drive trucks. So
the other half to desert racing is prep. So you guys build the cars there, but then you're also taking on the RPM group and doing all their race prep for them. What goes into prep for a desert race?
Well, the RPM team, they have six trucks, and we also have two pre-runners and that we take care of in-house. But Clyde Stacy wants the trucks to be released. When they go to every race, they want to be brand new trucks. So when the trucks come back from a race, like they just got back from Imperial Valley, they'll come back, everybody unloads, they'll get washed, all torn apart. They'll get a checklist done of what's broken and everything, and we send parts lists and start getting stuff ordered. Motors come out on certain time limits, so they're all tagged. Every truck has spare motors, spare trannies, and diffs, so depending on time, they're switched out. Most of the time, every 1,000 miles to 2,000 miles, all the Heims are replaced. All the suspension components are torn apart. We also have an in-house Magnaflux machine, so we take all the axles out and spindles, and they're all Magnaflux to look for cracks and stuff. So they pretty much get torn all the way down to the frame and then put back together for every race, which most of the races are 2 to 3 weeks. So our mechanics are super busy. All the body panels are completely stripped and repainted because you can't just repaint over a body. It just keeps adding a layer. That's just more weight. So they get completely sanded down to fresh fiberglass, and then they're repainted and restickered every race. They get new, brand new tires every single race. So that's, most trucks take about 32 tires to a race. So we take at least 4 trucks a race. So that's a lot of tires. So, a lot of gas. We do a lot of gas stuff and everything. So the new game changer we test there is the pressure probes. So the trucks are now filled. We can fill 92 gallons of gas in less than 28 seconds. So we definitely are testing and making sure that system is basically 100%. You're dealing with fuel, and it's very quick to flame. And now that we pressurize, it's even more flammable. So we have to make sure all the systems are good to go. So we definitely take a lot of steps in trying to make the trucks better and just looking for that next step to keep them ahead of the game. So, but the prepping of it is really fun. We get to see the parts that fail, which is really nice, and what we can make better. So it helps us having that in the shop so that we can make the new trucks that much better or easier to work on. The mechanics will also give us feedback too. So they're like, oh, well, if you did this, it would make my life easier. So we just take that into advantage because the guys that we work with them, so we know who we want to make their life just as easy as ours. So we just kind of take that into contribution.
How big is Geiser Brothers, and how many people do you have working there?
I believe right now we have 23 employees. They're all split into groups. So we have like the fab shop, which is where they build the trucks. We have like the prep shop that you just talked about, that there's a mechanic for every truck. And then we have a pre-runner shop for where all the trucks are taken care of. We have 2 full-blown welders that all they do is weld all day. And then we also have our own machine shop. So we have a full in-house CNC shop and dyno in shop. So we have 3 guys in there. And then we also have a full-blown paint shop in our facility. So it's pretty, the whole shop is completely there. So we build everything almost from start to finish, so which makes it nice. So
you don't have to really be on anybody else's schedule. You guys are kind of in-housing.
Yeah, so it makes it really nice for us and easier to meet deadlines, especially with the deadlines we have. So,
well, Geiser Brothers is an awesome, awesome facility, obviously, as you guys have just heard. Produce awesome vehicles. And Nick, thank you so much for taking some time out of the show to talk to everybody. Such technology. I love it. I love it.
It's awesome. Thank you very much.
We're here with Kevin McCullough, and he is a pro buggy racer. Pretty exciting.
Yeah, very fun stuff. Raced the Lucas Oil Offroad Racing Series in the pro buggy class. It's open wheel class, spec motors, certain weight ratios, and then it's really a driver's class.
Yeah, so how many years have you been racing? What are some of your accomplishments?
I've been racing off-road short course for 3 years. I had a motocross background before that. Current accomplishments, I've got Lucas Oil Rookie of the Year in Pro Buggy last year, a Crandon World Cup, multiple wins in this class, and just a lot of fast lap awards. It's really fun and great to be out there getting the car. It's a real family sport. My dad, my mom involved. We got great sponsors behind us with Fraudulent Motorsports and Stapleton Roofing, and just everybody behind me. Just it's a fun family thing that we go out twice a weekend, once a weekend, and do.
Yeah. So what are some of the elements to pro buggy racing that somebody may or may not know by just watching a Lucas Oil race?
A lot of different elements compared to the trucks that you see a lot. We're on TV too as well with them, but it's more open wheel class, so the drivers have to be a lot more courteous to each other, because when you collect with open wheels, people get on their lid very quickly. So it's a lot of respect towards our competitors, and it's a driver's class. You learn and you develop your driving skills in this class, and it really produces some great talent throughout the sport.
So what's your next step? What's your next plan? What's your next truck?
Probably just continue with Pro Buggy for the next year, 2016, try and go full force and get the Lucas Oil Championship. Maybe get back to Wisconsin and see all those people back at Crandon, get another World Cup ring, and just have fun with it. Every day I'm out there, I'm happy to be there and excited and thrilled to be in this environment and this sport.
Awesome, I love it. Kevin, do you work on your own buggy?
Yes, I work full-time. I work for my dad's asphalt company, and then I get home and probably put 30 to 40 hours a week on the car. go to the sponsor's house and we build and fix and rebuild and try and develop new things to get faster and faster.
Cool. Well, there's a ton of technology, all kinds of fun, right?
Oh, always having fun, always having fun.
All right, well, that's Kevin right there. Now you guys can cheer him on while you're watching the Lucas Oil Pro Buggy class. We're here with Doug from TMW Offroad. Doug, you've been in the industry a long time as well with these side-by-sides, pretty much from the beginning, right?
Yes. Yeah, since 2004, building cages, doors.
And how have you seen the industry change the most? Clearly, it's been the vehicles, clearly all of that piece to it. But what have you done or seen really change from your perspective?
Well, the coolest thing about the way the industry is going right now is it's bigger and better, more horsepower, bigger vehicles. And now the economy is doing better. People are really getting out and playing. And so it's a neat place to be right now in the industry, watching things grow and change. And
you've taken two-seaters and made them fancy. Now you've got these awesome four-seaters that you were making.
Yes. Yeah, the four-seaters are, we've always been more of a four-seat. Even when we started, everybody's real family-oriented. People want to take their kids and go riding and do stuff. So the four-seaters have always been a big deal for us.
So we see these with the paddle tires on them. Is there something different to that build than with somebody that would just take it in the dirt?
Are you talking about this one right here? This build is a totally different vehicle because for the show, we wanted to show up with something that wasn't just like a normal Polaris Razor. A couple months ago, John Wolf from Wolf Designs came in. He's like, we need to step it up. We need something different. So we came up with the idea to put an LS2 V8 engine in the back of a Razor 1000 four-seater frame. And it's worked out really good so far. All the testing, it's an amazing vehicle, lots of power. And the fit and finish and all that stuff came out really well. So it's been really well received at the show. And I don't think we could have done a better job, you know.
Cool. Something that you'll see more and more of, something that you'll probably do in the future, or kind of more of a one-off build when somebody wants them?
Yeah, obviously this was just a full custom build. The cool thing about doing something like this is we have a ton of really talented employees, and they really wanted to show, hey, we can do more than just building a standard roll cage or doors. We want to build a custom suspension and put a motor in that's not supposed to be there and make it look like it was supposed to be there. And so that's what really this whole build is all about. Let's show you what TMW can do, what our employees are capable of. And that's what this machine's about. And I don't know if we'll do more of them or not. We have a lot of customers asking about it and wanting to do something like that in the Razor. So we'll see if we do more of those in the future or not.
Awesome. Well, like I said, TMW Offroad's been here since the beginning of the UTV. Not going anywhere. Clearly always like pushing the boundaries. I love it. Thanks, Doug.
Thank you.
We're out with Matt from the Arizona Game and Fish, and you guys do a lot to support the off-roaders, right?
Absolutely. We're here talking with folks about off-highway vehicle safety. We have our spin wheel that we bring out with us, and folks are able to spin the wheel and answer safety-related questions for different Game and Fish prizes.
Cool. So what's some of the main factors that you point out on safety?
Safety, the main thing that we try and focus on is making sure that people are compliant with helmets. And anyone under the age of 18 is required to wear a helmet in Arizona, regardless of the off-highway vehicle type, which most people don't know. They say, well, I'm in a side-by-side. Does my kid still need to have a helmet? And yes, they do. So that's dirt bikes, ATVs, and side-by-sides is really the main one we press, and then eye protection when you're riding out there as well.
Okay, so an adult doesn't have to wear a helmet in Arizona, but anybody under 18 has to.
Correct. That's kind of our main push. And then obviously long pants, over the ankle boots, gloves, all the additional long sleeves, those types of things are recommended, but obviously not required by law.
All right. How does the Arizona Game and Fish play into our off-road trail system here in Arizona?
So we receive $6 from every $25 off-highway vehicle decal sticker, and that then is divided between education, which is what we're here doing today, our information team that provides brochures, mapping, informational materials, and then also law enforcement. I believe we have 11 officers statewide that help enforce off-highway vehicle-related laws.
Excellent. Well, right here, Arizona Game and Fish, as you can tell, a great state that supports off-roading.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Thanks for coming out, and have fun out there. Ride safe.
Ride safe. Really excited to find Andrew McLaughlin from Letzroll Offroad here. How's it going?
Great, great. It's been an awesome weekend.
Yeah. So you have a shop here in town. You do a lot of builds for all the Jeep guys, and you're a racer.
Yeah, yeah. We kind of fill both markets. We have a shop here in Mesa, Letzroll Offroad. We deal with anything Jeep, truck, off-road. If it goes in the dirt, we deal with it. But yeah, we do a lot of racing too, for sure.
So how do you feel that your racing has helped your shop?
Mainly with my racing. What it is I get the connections and opportunity to deal with some of the highest end companies out there. So I'm bringing the tip of the spear into this market, whether it's tires or lights or wheels. You know, we're able to get in with these companies and prove we can use them to race, and it just trickles right down to the customers.
Got it. I love it. What kind of builds are you guys doing at your shops? Just like simple stuff or all the way through?
Oh man, we're a custom shop, so there's nothing's easy for us right now. We'll do anything from we're doing a resto Grand Wagoneer all the way up to full chassis builds.
Nice. Well, Letzroll Offroad, you guys see them in the ESOB car, right? Out at all the tracks, having a great time.
Yep. We'll see you soon. Keep us in your mind when you're out there rooting for racers.
The off-road is all about family. There's no doubt about that. We got Winnie and Erica and Dominic, and you guys are from Tucson and Chandler right here in Arizona. Is this a fun show or what?
This is amazing. This is insane. My first time.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
We come every year. Yeah, it's great.
So you guys are seeing all kinds of cool new cars and buggies, and you guys do the off-road, you do the sand. What do you do?
We are getting back into it. We've been at it for a little while, and so we actually bought one while we were here.
Loving that. What about you?
The new Yamaha is on our checklist, so we've already been looking at that for a couple weeks. We're ready to get him started on an electric dirt bike, so it's exciting.
Yay!
Sand, by the way.
Sand. Okay, sand. All sand. And this is exactly what these shows are about. It's all about the family, buying cool stuff, getting ready to buy cool stuff. And this guy right here, he's waving. I love it. We've been giving out kids' calendars to all the kids so that they can color. I love the family atmosphere. That's what it's all about.
When you're driving down the road, the last thing you want to think about is tires. Trust Discount Tire to get you up to speed on the right tire for your vehicle. Log on now to DiscountTire.com for the best deals on tires and wheels. We're America's largest independent tire store. Come check us out and we'll show you why. And remember, if ever you're not satisfied with one of our tires, please feel free to bring it back. Thank you.
Part of the Arizona Off-Road and Sand Expo is they're also added in the Arizona RV Expo. There's a ton of RV dealers here in Arizona. And what we're gonna do, unlike last week, we went and looked at all the toy haulers at the Sand Sport Super Show. This week, we're gonna check out all the fancy coaches because, you know, I love to dream. Looks like we got a checkmate going on here. So let's go see what we got out there. Well, it may have been a little bit too early to flop down onto this nice and fluffy bed right here, but a girl can dream, right? A girl can dream. Premium Coach Group. They brought out all these coaches. They're gorgeous. They do consignment, so if you want to sell your coach, you can do that. If you're looking to get one, you can do that also. So many different styles, so many different models, so many different options. I love it. Well, if you guys ever see me rolling in one of these, all I can say is I've been saving my pennies because I definitely, oh, yes, a girl can dream. Well, I think I found the one I wanted. 45 feet, 625 cat, 12-speed automatic transmission, and it has a independent axle in the rear for turning. Holy cow, this thing is awesome. I can totally see myself cruising down the road. What do you guys think? Bauer Power on the road? I don't know, we might have to do it. I'm loving it. We're here with Austin from the Bondurant School. It's super exciting. You guys teach us how to drive fast and on the edge, right?
Well, yeah, we do a lot of things, obviously, out the school. We have a lot of car classes where we teach a lot of high-performance driving and advanced road racing, Grand Prix road racing. But we also now have just introduced a side-by-side intro to off-road driving featuring the Polaris RZR 1000. We're partners with Ride Now with this program, so it's pretty exciting, and we're getting off the ground. It's really cool.
So this is a pretty interesting setup that you have here. You have your wings out, I guess, trying to get it up on two wheels, understand where the tip point is. What are we learning?
You know, a lot of the introduction class is based on safety and really how to learn how to manage these type of vehicles. Two of the most common issues in a side-by-side is either a head-on collision or a rollover. So with this particular vehicle, this is just a segment of our class, is we can teach people how to come out of a roll. So we actually put them up on two wheels in this vehicle, teach them the proper techniques on how to manage it and stabilize the chassis and come out of it. So a lot of it's muscle memory, and this allows us to, you know, also to identify when I am getting up on two wheels. There's a lot of body roll in these type of vehicles with a lot of suspension. So some of it's just body roll, but then there's that point where we get up on two wheels and start to tip. So we gotta, it allows the students to understand where that point is and recognize it and then react to it.
Great. What's one of the biggest questions that you have at a show like this?
Are these training wheels?
And the answer is yes, right?
Yeah, to a point. Obviously, they won't allow us to tip all the way over if we get to that point. That's what the chassis is for. But you can't experience getting up on two wheels or learn how to correct it without getting into that position or developing the sense of feel of that. So with this unit, our anti-rollover rig is what we refer to it as. It allows us to get the student in that position safely and teach them the techniques on how to come out of it.
Cool. So if they want to be part of your school, how do we do it?
You can go to bondurant.com on the website, sign up right there, or you know, call the 800 number to talk to one of our salespeople to get signed up on a class. And we'll come out and have a good time and be prepared to get a little dusty too.
We have Chris from the Arizona OHV Ambassadors with us, and I guess we're just going to start with, what does that mean? What do you guys do?
So we're a volunteer group. We go out and promote responsible OHV recreation throughout the state. We do trail maintenance. We do public outreach events like this today. We also do monitoring patrols. We'll go out. We'll ride the trails. We'll look for down signs, washouts on the trails, that type of stuff.
Okay, so an ambassador in my area, I guess, of expertise is people that just really love the trails, want to be part of it, and can join in. Is that also what you're working with? You're getting people to come and help you?
Correct. Yeah, so we're always looking for more volunteers to come out, help us do this type of stuff, talk about the sport, talk about what they like to do, and then as well as the trail stuff. So we have groups of guys that like to do the outreach stuff, and then we have the groups of guys that like to go out and dig holes and fix fences and all types of good stuff.
Yeah, yeah, the hole diggers are always
exactly.
The best ones, right? Yeah.
Do the labor-intensive work.
So you have a group of organizations behind us that you support. How does that work?
So the program's actually funded through state parks and the OHV sticker fund, so that little decal that you guys buy every year, some of that money comes to this program. So we do work with Game and Fish, Bureau of Land Management, Forest Service, the local law enforcement agencies. So we kind of support all the different agencies throughout the state.
Awesome. What's one of the bigger projects that maybe you guys have worked on just recently?
If you've been out to the Lake Pleasant area, the Boulder staging area, up off Carefree Highway Road, our volunteers were actually the ones who built that fence around the staging area. They also do the trail maintenance and put up the signs out there.
Cool. All right. Well, if you guys are looking for a way to support the Arizona trails, Chris is your man.
I sure am.
We're out here with Dave from Turtleback Trailers, and you guys have some really cool trailers.
All right, thanks.
Yeah. So they run behind Jeeps. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yep, Jeeps, any big off-road vehicle. We've got plenty of clearance, more clearance than what you've got on your rig.
So would this be something that I would actually take on a trail, or I would take to the trailhead, leave it, and then go?
Well, you could do both, but we just had a guy get back from the Rubicon. He's done two trips up the Rubicon with it this year. You can boulder with it. You can run it off-road at 80 miles an hour. It's built to last. It's hardcore.
Nice. So how does the design come together? Are there different models?
We have one basic unit. It's our Expedition model, and it's all laser cut, three-axis cut, chassis. We build it all up in a big fixture. It's built like you'd build any off-road vehicle. You know, it's built tough that way.
And how would we find one?
Okay, at turtlebacktrailers.com or we're at South Phoenix, 14th Street and Broadway. The trailer has 42 gallons of fresh water, a water heater, a shower, full kitchen, king-size bed up top, solar generator systems. It's basically you're living on the outside of an RV instead of the inside. You're not looking out through a porthole. You're living out in the elements, but you can take it all. I mean, I take them to places where I got to run 4 low to get to, and it'll take care of you.
When you're at a show like this, what's the number one question that you get asked?
Wow. You got me.
You've been getting a lot of questions.
A lot of questions. You know, it's I don't know. There's 1,000 questions. Will this pull behind my vehicle? And so, you know, if you've got a Jeep, it'll pull behind it. It only weighs 1,750 pounds. So if you've got a Jeep 4Runner or whatever, you know, small vehicle, we even have an aluminum one that'll pull behind a side-by-side.
Oh.
So, you know, yes, you can pull it. That really is the big question, is can I pull this behind my rig?
Very cool. Well, there you go, guys. Behind a side-by-side, behind a Jeep, we can go camping in style.
That's it. Glamping.
The Yamaha booth here is cranking. These guys are talking to everybody, and I'm not going to interrupt them. I'm just going to be dead honest with you. If you go back to our Sand Sports Super Show, you'll actually get a great interview with one of the guys from Yamaha. But so what I thought I'd bring in really fast is the engine. This is a 998cc engine, triple cylinder. So it comes out of their snowmobile group. So it's really, really strong, and it's proven. It's not something that's new. The other thing that I guess the main question here in the booth is, when do I get one and how do I get one? Well, the yellow 60th anniversary editions are shipping now, so you may be able to find one, but more than likely, they're already pre-sold. The blue and white and the orange will be available in December, but like I said, I would actually go to your local dealer right away and get one on order, put your name on it, make sure it comes in, and they call you first. These things are out of control. There's been a half hour wait just to sit in one today. Like, that's awesome. Way to go, Yamaha. And again, another great product. I'm here with Kara from Vern Lewis, and you guys are having all kinds of fun out here.
We are. We have 3 different welders set up. We have MIG welders, TIG welders, we have plasma cutters. Anybody can come and try it. Doesn't matter if you know how. If you've never done it, we will show you the ropes. We've had little kids out here welding. We've had expert welders. So it's for all ages. We just want people to come and try the machine and have a good time.
Nice. So what machines do you have out?
We've got a Lincoln 210, which is Lincoln's newest and hottest item. It's basically a 3-in-1 machine, so people can come and try that. We have a Lincoln rep out here today, so he can answer any questions. We have a couple of Victor plasma cutters, and we also have a Victor rep here today. So any questions for the professionals, they can ask away.
Nice. What is what's the most fun piece about watching people weld for the first time?
I think I like watching the little kids come and weld, because they're so excited when they see like the spark and the fire, and then they just get really into it, and most little kids, it just comes natural to them, so it's really fun watching them.
But the guys too, like, they're coming and they're trying and they're seeing if it's an upgrade from their old welder or getting into it for the first.
Some of them are like looking, you know, well, they have an old machine, they want to see what the new ones are, or they're in school and they just want to, you know, show their buddies what they've learned and kind of show off. So yeah, it's a fun thing for all ages.
Cool. Well, Vern Lewis out here doing welding demos. Well, not even demos, right? Like, hey, do it yourself.
Yeah, do
Very
it yourself.
Cool idea.
Yes, thank you.
Are you driver enough to handle the ultra-high performance of the new BF Goodrich G-Force Comp 2 all-season tire, or the rugged toughness of the all-terrain TAK02? From August 31st to September 27th, get a $50 or $70 MasterCard reward card after submission when you buy a set of 4 new BF Goodrich passenger or light truck tires. Head to your local BF Goodrich dealer today. See redemption form for complete offer details. Offer expires 9/27/2015. Void where prohibited. Reward card issued by U.S. Bank pursuant to license from MasterCard International Incorporated.
We're back in the local motors booth with Buddy Chris, but now we're talking about something like we can all afford, right?
Yes, there you go.
Verado tricycles. Is that what we're calling them?
Verado drift trike.
Drift trike.
I do call them tricycles with the boys and mess with them. So I'm like, go ride your tricycle. But yeah, they're drift trikes.
Well, these things are fun. Oh my gosh, they're like drifting around out there. They got the back squirrel, the front squirrel.
Yeah, they're a blast. We have great rubber front tire, rubber on the back, but we put this PVC sleeve over the tires to break traction. So you can slide around the parking lots and do donuts and slide into your buddies, and you can even crash once in a while. Be careful. I think some of the boys got a little crazy this morning when we were riding around, but it's fun.
So how do these work? It looks like it's electric powered.
It is fully electric powered. Local Motors is kind of delving into the electric transportation industry, and this is a battery in the back. Wires come up the head tube to a hub motor in the front of it. Ride them for about an hour and then recharge for 2 hours and get another hour of ride time out of them.
What's the speed capability?
We send them out of the factory at 22 miles an hour. That's what they'll go. You can do a little tweaking with the wattage of the batteries. You can, like everything, to go a little faster if you wanted to. We'll talk to you about that off camera. We can't really broadcast that online.
Oh, we get all the inside secrets. Hey.
Most definitely. Most definitely.
Cool. Well, these look like a ton of fun. Thank you so much.
Oh, you're very welcome, and thanks for coming out and riding them with us.
We're here with Cory Sappington from Dezert Toyz. How are you doing?
Good, really good. Just came back from SCORE Imperial Valley 250 yesterday, where I think we finished fourth. And it was a really rough course and had some crazy things happen, like Mark Burnett.
So you guys race side-by-sides, Can-Am right now.
Correct. I race for Can-Am, and I also manage the class for Best in the Dezert and consult for SCORE on rules and classifications and such. And really excited for next season with Yamaha presenting their new sport model and the opportunity to have another manufacturer racing for a title. And so the Yamaha will race in the pro production class with all the other UTVs. That class is designed for whatever comes off the showroom floor. So manufacturers build it, you go buy it, turn it into a race car, come out and race with us. We're the largest class in off-road racing, and super exciting.
Nice. Okay, so let's back up on that a little bit, because I'm not sure a lot of people understand. So when the UTVs very first came out, all the desert racers had classes that all the cars fit into. Well, there was not really any place for the UTVs to fit, right? And they all had different CCs, they all had different stock packages, and then all of a sudden we came out with all of this aftermarket goodies. So you were the main man that helped try and sort all these different classes out into how many classes are there now?
Right now we have three classes. We have pro production, which is anything comes off the showroom floor. We have unlimited, which you could do a full tube chassis, you can do multiple shocks. And then we have sportsman class for the guys that want to come out and just have the experience. Although in the sportsman class, still have to say, have all the safety equipment that you would in the other classes. But it's less money to enter, and you're not racing for points, and it's a way to get your feet wet.
Cool. So Best in the Dezert, SCORE, and pretty much all the desert racing series are going with those three classes.
Yeah, there's a few of the grassroots series that have the CCs broken down, and that's a good another good way to get your feet wet to try UTV racing before you build up to a Best in the Dezert or a SCORE car. Those grassroots racing series, they allow you to run a stock gas tank and have a little less safety gear and stuff like that, but it's a shorter circuit, it's a shorter race. Medical help is close by, and therefore you're not putting yourself in jeopardy like you would in a Baja 1000 or a Vegas Torino.
Sure, that makes sense. When you're talking about safety, what are the minimum safety requirements that I would say a series would recommend, but also that you would recommend?
Well, certainly 5-point harnesses, helmets, fire suits, fire extinguisher, nets, doors, just to keep all your body inside the car if you do have a rollover, and then of course fire extinguisher so that if you have a fire you can put it out.
Cool. And your Can-Am behind us fits into what category?
This Can-Am races in pro production.
Very cool. Well, Cory Sappington, again, one of the OGs of the UTV world. There's quite a few of us here this weekend. It's pretty fun, huh? And more information about all the different classes. I think it's really interesting.
Yeah, and this show is awesome. It's super classy and nice and air-conditioned, and Andy Myers did a great job putting on this show. We're so happy to have it back in Arizona.
All right, Dezert Toyz, Arizona local. Well, we're here with Lewis and Edgar from Locomoto, and these guys are doing something that I love, and that is drag racing quads, right? As you guys can see, they're super awesome. There's all kinds of different setups. There's Banshees and they're 250Rs underneath them, but you can't really tell sometimes, right? So what are some of the fun pieces to these bikes?
Me personally, fun pieces, every bike is built differently just to every individual's personal likings. The themes, you have Call of Duty themes, you have Hello Kitty themes. I mean, it's endless.
I think one of the other fun pieces is the fuel that you guys run too. It's not all just normal fuel.
No, it's not. It's racing fuel with methanol, nitro, mixing it with NOS. That's it.
And then you also have carburetors in there. So when you're playing with the methanol, when you're playing with all that, the heat, the temperature, the elevation, everywhere that you're at matters. Like, I've seen you guys pulling carbs right there and changing it in order to make it run right.
That's right. Every place that we go to, it's different elevations, different temperature, humidity, everything makes a big difference.
What about the length? We see some like hugely extended swing arms here. Some are really pushing the front tires forward. What's the difference there?
It depends on the motor, trying to keep it there. The tires, it depends on the track you're at, the hill you're at. I mean, everything changes. I mean, you build a big motor, either you put more paddles to it, extend it more, or cut it short.
Is there a different setup between going flat and straight versus going up the hill? Would you take a different bike or would you just do a different setup?
A different setup. Everything's different. It changes.
So I would have a different bike for that, or I would just like change a few things, and what would I change?
If you were to change, I think the majority will be the paddles, the gearing, to get it there, strut it out, take all the shocks out to make it run on the 300 foot. I mean, you don't have to build another bike. If you're gonna go straight 300 foot, then yeah, you need a rigid bike.
Awesome, well, you guys, again, this goes back to my days in the sand. There's all kinds of sand drags out there, and these things are a ton of fun. They're so loud and exciting, and like, you just hold on, right?
Big adrenaline rush.
Yeah, love it. So glad to see so many out here at the show. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Well, we found Wayland Campbell running the aisles, and right behind us is his Ultra 4 car. Very exciting.
Yeah, you know, I'm having a good time out here at the Arizona Sandsport Show, and letting people see my new ride.
Yeah, so it's your new ride. Now, this is actually your dad, Shannon's, old car, right, is what you've moved into?
Yeah, it's the perfect hand-me-down for anybody.
Yeah, I'd like to have that hand-me-down. Single seat compared to two seats, how has that been different for you this year?
It's what I started in, and, you know, I'm trying to readjust and get back to driving single seat and being in the center of the car, and, you know, it's a slow process, but it's going good.
So you guys have done really, really well this year, all three of you, your dad, Shannon, sister, Bailey, and you, of course, and East Coast and West Coast, and now into the Nationals. What was the highlight of your year so far?
The highlight of my year has probably just been the fact that I can keep up with everybody. And I, you know, I got more motor, and I can, you know, just going back and forth with Lauren, and I'm just trying to beat him. And, you know, it hasn't happened yet, but one of these days.
One of these days. That's a goal list.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
King of the Hammers coming up quick already. My gosh, right? What's on your guys' schedule for that?
Just a lot of prepping and getting the cars ready. You know, all three of us are going to be racing this year, and I'm thinking about attempting this race in the single-seat car. So we'll see what happens.
Very cool. And your dad is also building a new car that we're getting ready to unveil. Excited about that?
Yeah, very. It's been a long process, but, you know, I'm excited. It looks... It's awesome. It's a piece of art, and I'm ready to see it tear up the desert.
Awesome. Well, Wayland Campbell right here. Exciting to see the next generation of Campbells, like, stepping up and making it work out on the track.
Yep. Thank you.
We made it into the Schampa booth, and you guys always have awesome products. Tell us about some of the things that maybe are new.
Well, the newest thing we have here is the face fit line. So we have it in the tie and Velcro. The cool thing about this is the wire that we put in here. So it will pinch in, and it will keep the mask secured, as well as we have a 3D mesh, which is a better filtration. So it will keep a lot of dust out. It's lined with the cool skin. And then we have it in the tie and Velcro.
So actually it fits to your nose now, where it doesn't just like awkwardly sit there, and it's not hot.
Exactly. Actually, I can show you here really quick, if you don't mind. See, you have this one over here. So you just pinch it in. So no fog in the bike wear. Everything it goes down and it stops all dirt from getting in.
I love it. Isn't that cool? Just like super simple. Side-by-sides, Jeeps, motorcycles, anybody, right?
Oh, of course. Yeah. This is universal all year long.
So you also have the tubes, which are even more simple, where you just put them on, you pull them up.
Absolutely. You more than 10 ways you can wear it.
So Schampa is a whole line of outfitting to be safe and less dirty.
That is true. Yeah. It will
protect. Is less dirty a great word?
I don't know about that, but we definitely have all weather gear, cold weather, you know, summer, all year long. We have what you need.
All right, check them out, Schampa.com. I'm here with Sam from Street Grafx, and I found something new. It's always so exciting. So you guys are doing graphics for Jeeps, but not just like boring graphics, cool graphics.
We're looking to make graphics that you can't get OEM and OEM, but we want something that everybody's looking for that's unique and different.
So you have the hood graphics, you have side panel graphics, and you cut them and ship them, and they're ready for people to install?
Correct. And if you can't install it, there's always somebody locally that can. Your tinters or your local sign shops can install them for you.
Oh, that's easy, right? So you get the graphic, and then say you don't feel comfortable with it because it can go sideways. It can go real sideways real fast. Mm-hmm. And you get somebody local.
Correct. And it's affordable. These are the same graphics we offer to all the dealerships. And you can actually buy them yourself, save yourself some money, and, you know, for the most part, have your own look.
Okay, so what's affordable?
For example, a hood graphic. Right now, we're looking at introducing this complete hood graphic for like $65 to $70 online.
Oh, that's not bad, and it looks super cool. And then the graphics on the side, I'm seeing like you have cityscapes, and you have different scenarios there too.
If you look here, we've got like the dune look, the desert look, kind of the raptor look, a monster look. I mean, we just want to, you know, provide anything and everything for people that just want to be different. So the rocker graphics. And
pretty much all black, or are you guys going to go different colors?
Any color you can imagine.
All right. Well, their website is new, so make sure you guys go check it out at
streetgraphics.com.
All right. Yay. Always love finding the new stuff. All right, we're here with Andy Myers. Congratulations on an awesome show.
Yep, it's been a long time, huh? 8 years since Arizona's had an official off-road expo. We brought back the original and largest off-road sand expo. What can one say? It's amazing. Arizona clearly wanted this.
Yeah, I think everybody here can say two thumbs up. Thank you so much for bringing it back. We actually have plenty of vendors that have said that as well earlier. A lot of work, a lot of effort.
This was a lot of effort. A lot of risk taking here. I didn't know if it was there or not. And goodness gracious, it was huge. It was amazing.
So Westworld of Scottsdale. Yes. You changed your location from before. Very nice, like air conditioned, you guys, in Arizona in September.
Yes, indoors, everything. I'm blown away by the facility. I was blown away when they offered it to me. I mean, just to make it more spectacular, next year we've got SCORE coming. It'll be the SCORE Off-Road and UTV Expo. We did change the name of it from sand to UTVs because it's so big. So we also have Geico Transworld Enduro Cross coming in the hall behind here. We have so much going on next year that this show will blow up.
All right, guys, you heard it here. Next year, make sure you put it on your calendar. More and more and more.
I just want to get it to the point where everybody here can come to Arizona. We have great bars. This is a great location for bars, restaurants, resorts, wonderful hotels. Private jets can fly right in. You got great flights into Phoenix Sky Harbor. It's really close. It's accessible. Everybody knows it because of Barrett Jackson's. And we've got it, and Arizona's got it, and Arizona's second largest off-road market in the world, so let's bring it.
You know, one of the things that I thought was really interesting was I got some feedback of, wow, I didn't realize how many Arizona companies there are that build things for the off-road. Like, they're right here in Phoenix. They're in Mesa. They're here. It's not just a Southern California market.
No, that's I think me and you discussed. A lot of people were concerned about this and when we put the show on because of show dates, races, and things like that. And I try to emphasize, the off-road market is more than just off-road racing. It's off-road recreation. So the recreationalists, there's so much here. And yes, we've got Rigid, Vision X, we've got SDHQ, we've got Geisers, we've got Get Bent, TMW, we've got so many big companies here building stuff. We've got we got Lucas Regionals here, which is phenomenal. It's one of the best race regional courses here in the country. What else can you say? It's the state of Arizona. When you think of California, you think of Kim Kardashian, you think of hipsters, you think of little surfer boys near the beach and things like that. You think of Arizona, you think of the Old West, guns, outlaws, and off-road and in desert, right? So why shouldn't we have the largest off-road expo in the world?
I love it. All right, Andy. Well, that right there is the enthusiasm that made this happen. Thank
Absolutely.
You.
Absolutely. It's my passion. I want to see businesses grow. I want to see businesses prosper, and I want to see my industry do well.
I agree. Thank you, Andy. We're here with Jason from KC Highlights, and how was your weekend? Isn't this fun?
I got to tell you, being a hometown show for a company that's from Arizona, amazing. I was really impressed with the show. I was really impressed with the crowd and the receptiveness to all the new products that we have and having better performance for whatever their apparatus is.
So KC Highlights is commonly known for the old school cool light that's like on the front of all the old trucks, right?
Yeah, so, you know, I didn't get a girlfriend in high school until I had KC Daylighters, right? Yeah. You know, so that was the big thing. But now there's so many more options out there, and now we're known more for like the HIDs in the desert. You know, when Rob McCracken and Jason Voss and Cameron Steele and Larry Rossler, all those guys were running our products, but it's all HID. Yeah. Nobody thinks LED when they think of KC Highlights, and that's really one thing that we've really been pushing hard at shows like this. You know, the problem with the HID is that it has a large format. So you got a big bulb, you got a big housing, things like that. They're not cute, they're not sexy like the LEDs, and so we're able to put something together like that for it.
Okay, so what is the difference, layman's term, between the HID and the LED?
So HID is let's call it a welder's arc, okay? So you have a really, really hot gas in a bulb with some crystals and a whole bunch of wazoo stuff, and it works because there's a ballast that supercharges it, and pow, there you go, all right? But again, it has to take a really big depth to make any sort of distance. But we can outdistance any LED on the planet with our HIDs. However, 70 watts, 50 watts, they draw a lot of power and they're a big format. It's hard to put one on a little Razor, hard to put one on an Articat or something like that. So the LEDs, diode based, right? And so because of that, we can put it in a really small package. The inherent problem of most LEDs is that the light source is so close to the edge of the lens that you don't get much distance with them. So our new flex system, our new gravity system is kind of mixing both of them. We're a lot longer in our reflector, and because of that, we're getting more performance and more control of the light.
And we also have a difference between a beam light and a wide angle light.
So the industry has so many different names for it, right? So there's a spot, there's long distance, long range, blah, 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 blah. Really, what you care about is three things. You care about, do you need distance? Do you need width? Or do you need a whole big ball of light, right? What do you want? And most everybody in desert racing, most everybody in the dunes, what works in the dust, right? So you have all those spectrums, and we have something for everybody.
Cool. And you really do have something for everybody. Like, the applications are across the charts, from motorcycles to side-by-sides to Jeeps to trucks.
Yeah, again, so like the LED problem, nobody thinks motorcycles when they think KC Highlights, but the fact of the matter is we're coming out with a whole new power sports line. And I say new because, I mean, there's bikes right behind me that have been running the product for 10 years. So it's really cool. We've had some success in Baja with our motorcycle program, but we're really diving in feet first. And we're absolutely taking over the market. We've got some big names coming out on the 24-hour race coming up at Glen Helen that'll be running our products. Chuck Dempsey's running that whole program. And, you know, when you have test guys like Larry Rossler, Cameron Steele, Brian Deegan, all those guys, when you have guys like that working on your motorcycle program, you know it's going to be successful.
All right, definitely agree. But now we're going to flip a page. We're coming off of KC Highlights. We're going to Jason Cobb.
Uh-oh.
Okay, are you ready for this?
Not really.
So we have been in the industry together for a long, long time. And I am always...
Don't say that. That makes us old.
Well, yeah. You know, whatever. I am always interested in your input and your vision of what this industry has become. So first of all, when did you start in the off-road industry?
Oh my gosh, 87. I was a wholesale manager at Apache, Honda, Yamaha, Suzuki, and I was a rider. Ironically enough, it wasn't until I was 18 in 88 that I was able to even have my first off-road vehicle. My mom would never let me have one. So I had to buy my own quad, and my girlfriend at the time, who's now my wife, she and I saved up and we bought the quad, and I went racing and I was in love. I only had a quad because I couldn't afford a race car, and in 94 I was able to go off-road racing for the first time and had some great success, and I was very fortunate. But this is where my heart is. This is where I want to be. My son's now racing, and every dad always dreams about their kid racing, and now I get to race with him. I mean, he's asked me to drive a little bit with him. He's asked me to coach him a little bit, so it's been great. This industry is so exciting right now. We have never seen the kind of off-the-shelf product that we have today that is able to do what we think it should have been able to do years ago, right? So, and without a designated race vehicle, without a designated chassis builder or something like that, we're actually having products that we can jump, we can race. My son, 2 weekends ago, was invited to drive in the Terracross program for PRP seats. And that's a stock vehicle, and we were racing them, and we were banging them, and we were flying them, and it took it just wonderfully. So we're in a great time to be off-roaders. With that comes responsibility, and I'm concerned. And I know you remember back when the whole quad deal took over that our industry really started to see a change about anybody can ride a quad, not many people can ride a motorcycle, and we had people that didn't belong on those vehicles riding them. So we had young kids, we had things like that. We really got to be careful as an industry that all these 1,000 turbos, big wheel travel, lots of performance, all those vehicles today, we just got to be responsible. And that's the biggest challenge that we're going to face. And then the other thing is finding quality products. Because the fact of the matter is, look at all the stuff around here, right? But which one works? Which one has the right geometry? Which one has, do your homework. There's great products out there, and there's great companies, and we hope everybody's success. But make sure you're dealing with a true fabricator, true designer, true geometry. All that stuff is so important, and you know that.
Yeah, it's been really interesting because as we see where you used to have to be a fabricator in order to get anything done on your vehicle or get anything accomplished, now we can actually walk into booths and have things that are already accomplished, but we just have to make sure it fits correctly to what we're trying to do with that vehicle.
Well, never before have we had specific applications for each model. It used to be you had to make it fit to what you tried to do, right?
And then you went like this.
Yeah, exactly. And maybe it lit up, maybe it didn't, maybe it worked, you know. But the fact of the matter is I mean, now they ask you make, model, year, and sometimes that's not enough, right? We need to know what 2-seat, 4-seat, you know, what are you doing with it? So it's so important, but it's so great for us as consumers and enthusiasts. As a manufacturer, it's extremely challenging on that side, but as an enthusiast, there's never been a better time.
I really appreciate you also bringing up the point about the 1,000 cc's and having the right people behind the wheels, because every day it gets more and more and more. Like, I talk to everybody, and that is the game. The game is horsepower right now, but we also have to teach how to drive and what to do with that horsepower, and it's not all about going fast. It's also about how to stop.
You know, and you and I have done some wacky things in some vehicles, and the fact of the matter is that if there is no car control, there's danger. And these things can be exhilarating, and they can do amazing things. But let's not ever forget that unless they've been heavily modified, they're not race cars. And even though there's a roll cage around us, that doesn't mean we're always safe. And the manufacturers have done an unbelievable job of putting these programs together, but within certain limitations. And how many times have we seen somebody go out and go, oh, I got this. They don't got it.
Well, thank you so much, Jason, for your time. And you guys, you know what? This show is closing down around us right now. We've done this both nights now. They're like moving stuff behind. So we're going to call it good. We're going to say right now, Bauer Power Hour, we're shutting down from another great weekend at the Arizona Offroad and Sand Expo. Thanks, Jason. Thanks to all the vendors. Thanks to Andy for bringing this show back to Arizona. Super excited. Hope you guys got some great information. If you need more, go to BauerPowerHour.com. We got links for everybody there. Thanks, guys. Charlene Bauer signing out. That was cool.
That was cool. Is there anything else incriminating you want to say?
I don't know. Did you get anything else incriminating from the weekend?
You used your blinker.
Oh, I always use my blinkers. I always check all my mirrors. But when I'm towing a trailer, here's something that's awesome. So right now, we're clearly not towing a trailer because I'm in the fast lane and we're doing what we're doing, but we're not even going fast, you guys. Like, we're only going 70. So I don't speed. I kind of drive more like a grandma more than anything. But when I'm towing a trailer or when I'm driving, I have some serious pet peeves. Number one, don't sit in a blind spot. On mine, or I sit in somebody else's, like, serious pet peeve. And when you're towing a trailer, I believe your turn signal is your intent. So if you see a trailer put their turn signal on, they're coming over. Like, that's just the way it is. Like, I know I'm coming over. That's just the way it is. And so sometimes when people sit in my blind spot and if they're just there entirely too long, especially with the trailer, I just give them a little swerve swervy, and it's amazing. Somehow they find their gas pedal, like, psh, they're out of there.
Want to learn more about the guests on today's show? Visit www.bauerpowerhour.com for more information, photos, and videos. Follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter by searching for Bauer Power Hour Show for daily breaking news updates.